Revelation chapter 3 and verse 14. That's going to be our passage. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to see how an Old Testament passage is used in the New Testament. As you read Revelation 3:14, Revelation 3:7, it says, "To the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, he who is holy, who is true, who has the key of David, who opens and no one will shut, and who shuts and no one opens." Now, as we're going to see, that's from Isaiah 22:22. And what we want to do is prepare for the workshop. So I'm going to go through what I believe are 9 steps for interpreting an Old Testament reference in the New. You can use this for a quotation. You can use this for an allusion. If there's a clear reference in one way or another to the Old Testament in the New, this will be a 9-step way to interpret it. So before I begin formally, just a few comments. Again, this is to prepare us for the workshop. Now, this is not a workshop where we, you know, get together in groups, you know, around the table, and we kind of corporately decide among 4 or 5, what does this mean? Sometimes that works. Sometimes that doesn't work. And what we're going to do is we're going to divide into 3 groups after this message, and we're going to try to apply the steps I've used on another Old and the New passage. And it's going to be it's one of the more exciting passages in all of the New Testament, in my opinion. And so each of the leaders, me, Tyler Milliken, and Ben Glad, we're going to move through each step. And so we're going to present the step to you on the passage that we'll choose for you. And then you're going to be expected to think through that step. Write some notes yourself, just yourself. And then after a little period of time, we're going to come back and we're going to talk about that text. And different people will contribute different things. I'll interact. But it's a way for you to get on the inside of how allusions are used. How do we know something is an allusion or just a general conceptual parallel? I've given this conference once before, about 3 weeks ago in Florida, and I'd never done a workshop like this. I was most concerned about the workshop, and ended up, for me, and I think those there being one of the highlights. So I'm hoping that'll be the case here too. So this is not just some kind of thing we get together and we kind of talk in groups. You're going to work through each step yourself, then go over it with your leader. Now, just a comment about Tyler Milliken, who is our 3rd leader. Tyler was a doctoral student of mine. He's got his doctorate from Westminster Theological Seminary. He's now an adjunct professor there. And he is working on several commentaries for Lexham Press. And he and I have just signed a book contract with University Press to co-author a book, which is a popularization of my book, We Become What We Worship. This book will probably be titled We Become What We Revere. And so Tyler Milliken is an expert in the Old Testament. He did his dissertation on the use of the Old Testament in Revelation. So let's get started. Let's look at our passage again. Let's read it and pray. "And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia," Revelation 3:7, "he who is holy, who is true, has the key of David, who opens and no one will shut, and who shuts and no one opens, says this." Let's pray. Lord, be with us. Look at your word today. Teach us how to interpret your word. Cause us to be able to interpret your word in such a manner that we become confident in your word, so that we may have that confidence to preach your word, to teach your word. I pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Now, I want to read the rest of that passage, beginning in verse 8. "Behold, I cause those of the synagogue of beginning in verse 8. I know your deeds because I put before you an open door which no one could shut, because you have a little power and have kept my word and not denied my name. Behold, I'll cause those of the synagogue of Satan who say they are Jews and are not, but lie. Behold, I'll make them to come down and bow down at your feet to know that I have loved you. Because you've kept the word of my perseverance, I will keep you from the hour of testing, that hour which is to come upon the whole earth to test those who dwell on the earth. By the way, just parenthetically, that is probably the best text to support the pre-tribulation rapture of the church. Dan Wallace, who actually has his textual criticism ministry here, quite a biblical scholar, he affirms on the basis of this text, at least partly, that the church will be raptured before the tribulation. I do not hold that view, but that's just in passing. If you want to ask about that in question and answer, perhaps we can address it. That's not the purpose today, however, but it's very interesting. All right. Then, verse 11. I'm coming quickly. Hold fast what you have in order that no one take your crown. He who overcomes, I'll make him a pillar in the temple of my God. He will not go out from it anymore, and I'll write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God, my name. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Okay, so what we're going to do, we're going to go through these nine steps. You should have them in your packet. First of all, we're going to identify the Old Testament reference. Is it a quotation or an allusion? If it's an allusion, then there must be some validation that it is an allusion. In our case, in this passage, we're going to see it's not going to be too difficult. Some debate whether it's an informal quotation. Some debate whether it's an allusion. Whatever it is, it's clearly referring back to Isaiah 22. Now, in our workshop, this is not going to be the case. In the workshop, this is really going to be hard because you're going to see in the margins, we're going to present the margins in the Nestle-Aland Greek text to you, there are several Old Testament texts in the margin. And are some of these just conceptual parallels and they're not intended? Are some actual allusions? So this is going to be a true workshop and there'll be disagreement. Polite, humble. Disagreement, probably, among some of us on this. And this what we're doing is we're getting down into the trenches, getting down into the weeds of how you really do this. This session that follows this one, I think, I'm hoping and praying that it will mean a lot to you. Now, so that's the first thing we're going to do. And I will say, I guess it's okay to say this, that I spent an hour and a half session on this in Florida, and we spent 1 hour on step one. So I think we're going to have fun on step one, okay? So, but we'll get through it all, no matter how long we spend on step one. But the crucial thing is, what are the allusions there? Because there are a lot of them in the margin. So, secondly, analyze the broad New Testament context where the Old Testament reference occurs. Third, analyze the Old Testament context broadly. Where does it occur in the outline of the Old Testament book? And then, where does it occur? Where does your quotation or allusion occur in the paragraph in which it's in? Is it the main point? Is this a subsidiary point, etc.? And the paragraph it's in, what role does that play in the Old Testament chapter? All these are really important questions. I find the more and more that we're careful about examining, especially the immediate Old Testament context, the more light is going to be shed on the New Testament. I find that again and again and again. And then, number four, survey the use of the Old Testament text in early and late Judaism. Now, there's not going to be, we don't have the tools to do that here. And anyway, in this text, there's really not much to look at in Judaism, and in the workshop. In this case, there's not much to work out. So that's good, because we don't have the sources at our hands here to do that. But sometimes that can be very, very important. Sometimes early Jewish texts might give interpretations of your Old Testament passage that are really good. After all, remember, just as there were saints and true believers before the Reformation, there were saints and true believers before Jesus came. And they wrote commentaries on the Old Testament. Sometimes they were good. So that's important. Now, sometimes you'll find that early Jewish texts, maybe three or four, will comment on your New Testament passage and on that Old Testament text. And sometimes it'll be diametrically opposed to what your passage is saying about that Old Testament text. And in that case, that's also helpful, because it shows how different Christianity is from Judaism at that point. And then there are other times that you'll look at some of these Jewish texts and you'll say, I have no idea what that's saying and how that might help me. So sometimes that happens too. So then, got step 5 and 6. We ought to take those together. And step 5 is compare the texts, including their textual variants. New Testament. Now, LXX means Greek Old Testament. LXX is 70. Right? And there's a tradition that there were 70 translators. That's why the Greek Old Testament is called LXX. And then there's the MT, and all we mean by that is Masoretic text. That's the Hebrew text. And the Targums. The Targum is the Aramaic translation of the Old Testament. And we're going to see that has some relevance for us today, for our passage right now. And then some maybe early citations of your text in the Dead Sea Scrolls, in the Pseudepigrapha. This is just early Jewish tradition, these other things. Then what you do is, all you do is you put those texts in columns and you underline them. What are the differences? What are the similarities? And then you decide which text does the New Testament author rely on, or is the author making his own rendering? And how does this help us with the interpretation of the Old Testament? It may be sometimes the New Testament text will be quoting the Greek Old Testament, not the Hebrew. Why? And sometimes we'll find out. Sometimes an author quote the Greek Old Testament in order to bring out an interpretation that may only be subtle or in seed form in the Hebrew Old Testament. Because remember, the Greek Old Testament is not the original inspired writing, but it is an interpretation, and New Testament writers will draw on that to bring out the meaning of the Masoretic text. The fact that they will rely on the Greek Old Testament doesn't mean it's the original inspired Old Testament, but these are interpretations of the Old Testament. And then here's the key to me. It's all building up to 7, the number of completeness. Analyze the author's interpretative use of the Old Testament. Guess what we do there? We go to Ben Glad. Where is he? Put my laser on him.
We go and look at those 12 uses and we start troubleshooting. Is this direct fulfillment? Is this indirect typological fulfillment? Is this an analogy? So we start troubleshooting here at step number 7. And that's where we decide, what is the use here? What's the interpretative use? And then step 8, what we do is we look at the theological use. Does this deal with the person of Jesus? Christology. Does this deal with the person of God? Theology proper. Does this deal with something about the church? Ecclesiology. And so on. And we'll unpack that and talk more about it. And then lastly, we'll talk about the rhetorical use. And that's just a fancy way of saying, what's the pastoral use? What's the preaching use? What's the practical use of this passage? So that's what we're going to do. And what we're going to see in our passage is a pattern. And just as there are patterns, for example, you got the patterns of the Exodus, don't you? Israel goes through the sea. You have it replicated again, don't you, when the second generation goes through the Jordan. And Elijah goes through the Jordan and splits it. And then Isaiah prophesies that Israel is going to go through the sea again in a great restoration from exile. And then we find Jesus saying that's beginning. And then we have the final new heavens and earth. Or you have the patterns, if you will, of the Garden of Eden. I contend it's a sanctuary. And then you have the Temple of Israel having all these floral decorations. And what are they there for? I think it's to refer back to Eden. And so the pattern of Eden is replicated again. And then we find it again in the new heavens and earth in chapter 22, verses 1 through 2, where there's a new Garden of Eden. And intriguingly, it's part of a temple. A temple of the cosmos. Become the Holy of Holies. So we're going to see a pattern in our passage. We're going to have to wait to see it. But so the first thing we're going to do then is we're going to start our ninefold approach, and we want to identify our passage. So we're going to come back to one. Identify the Old Testament reference. Is it a quotation or an allusion? And as we'll see, it's hard to know, but it is clear that this is a reference to Isaiah. I'm going to have to really scroll down here. Oops. Because I want to go to the I don't have any quick way to get there, unfortunately. Let my fingers do the clicking. Okay. That is the, we could compare our passage in Hebrew, the Greek Old Testament, and the Greek New Testament, but for our purposes, we can use the English. And so you'll notice here that that our passage here in the Hebrew Bible is very similar to Revelation. You notice in both, you've got he who opens, no one shuts, he who shuts, no one opens. That's what you find right here. The main difference here is God gives the key to Eliakim. Here, Jesus already has it, and the shoulder mention is missing. But otherwise, it's the same. Now look at the middle. That's the Greek Old Testament translated into English. And this is a beautiful example of what the Greek Old Testament will do, especially in the book of Isaiah. It'll take expressions from Isaiah that are figures of speech, and it will interpret those figures of speech. So here we've got, I will give the glory of David to him. No mention of glory here in the Hebrew. It looks like he's interpreting key of the house as glory, and he goes on, and he will rule. He also interprets key of the house as rule. And so he's understanding the word key in two ways. It represents glory, the key of the house, and it represents rule. That appears to be what's going on. This seems to be equivalent to key of the house. And then, notice, and there will be no one contradicting him. And that's really an interpretation of to whom he opens, no one shuts, and whom he shuts, no one opens. We'll see that no one can prevent an opening if Eliakim opens. And if he shuts, no one can open that door. And the Old Testament Greek interprets that there'll be no one contradicting him. Okay. It's very clear, isn't it, that our passage is not relying on the Greek Old Testament. It's relying on the Hebrew, okay? And then we can ask why. Why is it relying on the Hebrew? I think it's just to make the same point that the Hebrew was making, to underscore that. Whether this is a quotation, it's very close to it. If it's not, it's one of the clearest allusions you're going to find in the New Testament. It's definitely to Isaiah 22 and verse 22. So that's step number one then. Identify the New Testament reference. That's not going to be so easy in the workshop. So get prepared. Now we want to analyze step number two. Let's come back. And coming to step number two. I'm going to go way back here. Well, step number two is analyze the broad New Testament context where the Old Testament reference occurs. Now, that is not too difficult here because our passage is found as the sixth of the letters. And what we find in the letters is this. You find in the letters a sevenfold pattern. First of all, what you find is the command to write to an angel of a church. They all begin the same way. To the angel of the church of Ephesus write. To the angel of the church of Thyatira write. Then, and this always happens, two, a self-description by Christ from chapter 1, introduced by the introductory formula, these things. These things says the one who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands, etc. In our passage, it says these are the things, the holy who is true, who has the key of David, who opens and no one will shut, and who shuts and no one opens. So that's the second part. And it's intriguing that each of these self-introductions in each of the seven letters goes back to chapter 1. Something in chapter 1. It's either interpreting it or developing it in some way. And so that's going to be important for us. Now, as this goes on then, we have a commendation of a church's good works. Lax in Laodicea, that's because it's the worst church. And an accusation because of some sin. And then we have step 5 in the letters, exhortation to repent with a warning of judgment or an encouragement. And then an exhortation to hear, usually. And then a promise to the conquerors. Now, number 6 sometimes comes after 7. There's not great significance to that. But basically, the step number 4 was accusing them of some sin. And 5 is that they should repent. And then together with who Christ is and the accusation of the sin and the exhortation to repent, on the basis of that, he who has an ear, let him hear. Hear what Christ is saying and then repent as a conqueror, overcome. It may be overcoming your sin. It may be overcoming fear of persecution, whatever it is, overcome. If you've been convicted of sin, overcome your sin. And here's the main point of all the letters. It's the promise. The promise that we inherit life with Jesus Christ in various ways. That's expressed at the end of each of the letters as a promise. So all the letters are moving toward the inheritance with Christ. The promise to inherit a living, saving, resurrection life with Christ. So, now in the letters to Smyrna and to Philadelphia, you don't have steps 4, accusation of sin, and step 5, an encouragement to repent, because they're not guilty of any major sin. They're not perfect, but they're not guilty of any major sin as the others are. In fact, it's very interesting parenthetically. If you look at the structure of the letters, the first church and the last are the worst. Laodicea, nothing good said about it, as we just noted, as something good always said about the other churches. Nothing good said about it. It's on the verge of extinction. Christ wants to spew them out of his mouth. Likewise, really, Ephesus is not far behind Laodicea. He says, I'm going to remove your lampstand unless you repent. He's going to disown them. He's not going to identify with them as a church of God. The lampstand, remember? Who are they? The churches. and their lampstand a witness. That's the essence of who they are as a church. And so then you have the second letter and the sixth letter as churches that have no accusations, Smyrna and Philadelphia. Now, our letter is Philadelphia. The middle three letters are not too good. The churches are in not great shape. Not as bad as Laodicea and Ephesus, but they've got some serious problems. And so I think what that tells us, I think number seven is a number of completeness and the number of the church universal. John's not just writing to five churches or 12 or eight. Why is he writing to seven? He's writing because he's writing to the church universal of the first century and all ages, of course, directly focusing on the church of the first century. And so what we find then is that the outer borders of the structure, things are bad. The middle, things are not good. And then listen to the middle verse. Verse 23 of chapter 2. I will kill her children with pestilence. All the churches will know I am he who searches the minds and hearts. I'll give to each one of you according to your deeds. Judgment. I think the point of the structure of the letters is the majority of the church in the first century is not in good shape. There are only two. And that's why in chapter 11, you have two witnesses. Is this Elijah and Moses or Elijah and Enoch coming back, or Peter and Paul who've been martyred, they're going to be raised up again? Many think they're two individual prophets who breathe fire, etc., out of their mouths. They're lampstands, it says. Well, we've already had them defined in chapter 1 and through chapters 2 and 3. They're the churches. But some will say, no, they've got to be individuals because there are only two. There aren't seven. Well, why are there only two? Because there are only two faithful churches in these letters. And so this is the faithful remnant church who is the witnessing church. And so Philadelphia is one of our churches here then that has no accusation. And again, the main point here is in the promise to the conquerors. Now, in our case, remember in Philadelphia, we don't have elements 4 and 5, conviction of sin and then exhortation to repent. We just have Christ presenting himself as who he is, saying what's going to happen. Says, I know you have a little power. And he says, I'm going to open doors for you. And that door is described in verse 9 as causing those of the synagogue of Satan who say they're Jews or not, I'll make them to come and bow down at your feet and to know I've loved you. It's a door of witness. In fact, when you find the phrase, an open door, if you do a concordance study on that in the New Testament, it's always an open door of witness. God's going to bring about an effective witness. And so that's what's happening here. And then in verse 10, he says, I'm going to, because you've kept the word of my perseverance, I'll keep you from the hour of testing. I think he's going to keep them through tribulation, not out of it. I'd be happy to talk more about that. And he says, I'm coming quickly. Then on the basis of who he is, that he's going to open doors for them of witness, even though they have a little power in comparison to the culture they live in, and the fact that he's coming quickly, on the basis of that, he says, overcome. Overcome the particular problems that you have in the churches, because indeed he has told them in verse 8 that you have a little power. You've kept my word and have not denied my name. So they're going through some tribulation here. So he says, if you overcome that, then I will make you a pillar in the temple of my God. And then he concludes, hear this. Take this in and respond and overcome. So that's the point, the context of the New Testament here, Roman numeral 2. And the main point really is with the promise to the conquerors. And Jesus' self-description, what is that form? It occurs in verse 7. It's part of the basis that's leading to them overcoming. How is it the basis? Well, we're going to have to see. So that is the New Testament context. That's you, what you want to do if you're in a, let's say you're in the book of Acts and you're in chapter 13. You want to see, what's the outline of Acts? And then you want to say, where does chapter 13 fall? How does it relate to chapter 12, etc.? So that's what you'd want to do there. Here we're looking at this in the context of the letters. So the third step in what we're doing, notice, number three, analyze the Old Testament context, both broadly and immediately, especially thoroughly interpreting the paragraph in which the quotation or allusion occurs. And as I said, the more you analyze the Old Testament context, the deeper you get into it, the greater riches you'll find, and usually more insights for the New Testament. In fact, there was an evangelical Reformed scholar who disagrees with me on this issue of the Old and the New. He thinks that the New Testament writers can take Old Testament texts and use them for their own purposes, not in line with the meaning of the original Old Testament text. And usually there are some difficult Old Testament and the New text. I'm not going to say there aren't. There are. I'm not sure. I know that I don't have the answer to all of some of these difficult texts. So sometimes you leave them as they are. Don't force some kind of a harmony on them. But usually I find that if there's a problem of use of the Old and the New, it doesn't, you know, I'm sure you've read an Old Testament quotation. You said, what is that doing there? It sticks out like a sore thumb. I'm sure you've had that experience. And I find again and again, when you go to the Old Testament, usually you dig into it, you understand it. Well, this particular scholar who disagrees with me, and he was interacting with me, he says, Greg Beale, when he finds a problem of Old and the New, he just says, go back to the Old Testament and dig more and more, and you'll usually find the answer. And that was really meant as ridicule. I take that on completely. That's true. He couldn't have summarized me better, but I don't. I think he made a mistake in using it as ridicule. But anyway, so that I find that to be the case. So broad Old Testament context, and this is where a lot of the riches are going to come from, as I've said. So let's look at this. And again, I want to say, for sale is this little book called Handbook on New Testament Use of the Old. And I dedicate that book to one of my professors, S. Lewis Johnson, who that book is a big expansion of what he taught me. And he got me interested in the use of the Old and the New. And I'll never forget learning about the riches of the Old Testament and the New through his wonderful teaching. So let's look at this. First of all, let's look at the broad Old Testament context. And this is pretty simple. You look at Isaiah 1 to 39. Why 1 to 39? Because Isaiah's in two halves. 1 to 39, 40 to 66. Now, some think because they are clearly in such two distinct halves that the second is not by Isaiah, and the first, there are parts from Isaiah and some not. I think Isaiah is the author. One reason I do is because he's listed as the author at the beginning, and there is no change about that. There are many reasons. I have an essay in a book that I wrote called The Erosion of Inerrancy in Evangelicalism, in which I take a whole chapter to talk about why I think Isaiah wrote the whole book, because part of the erosion of inerrancy among evangelicals is a lot of them say, oh, Jesus, Isaiah didn't write all of Isaiah. And when Jesus says he did write it, Jesus is accommodating himself to the culture. Either Jesus really did think he wrote it, and he didn't, or Jesus is sort of going along with the Jews who think that, and he doesn't want to, upset the apple cart. Those kind of options are not too attractive for me. I think if Jesus said it, as Ben Glad said, hey, if Jesus said it, I'm going to go with Jesus and not the biblical critics who don't think Isaiah wrote those parts that Jesus says that he did write. And by the way, We're not just talking about use of the old and the new here. In this particular case, about Isaiah, when Jesus says that this is a fulfillment of Isaiah, and other scholars say, no, Isaiah didn't write that. Jesus wasn't quite right. We're not just talking about old and the new. We're not just talking about interpretation. We're talking about Christology. Who is Jesus? Did he just accommodate himself to false Jewish tradition? I don't want to upset the apple cart. Or did he really believe it and it wasn't true? Those are not very good options, and I don't take them. So if you're interested, I do have a chapter there. Maybe the theme of this conference could be see chapter so-and-so of Beale's book and chapter so-and-so of Beale's other book and so on. I'm sorry, but I can't take time to summarize it all. So what we have here then is the first 35 chapters of Isaiah are prophecies of condemnation. The broad idea of Isaiah 1 to 39 is this. This is the main idea. As I've looked at it, worked in it, that holy Yahweh punishes unholy humanity for three reasons. Okay, so holy Yahweh punishes unholy humanity for three reasons. Number one, to execute judgment. Number two, to purge a faithful remnant. And number four, to restore a Davidic kingdom. And all of that will demonstrate God's glory. Now the context, this is really important, the context leading up to our passage, you get chapters 1 to 6, which is coming judgment on Judah. Chapter 6 climaxes it. It's one of the hardest texts in the world. But basically, you remember Isaiah's commission, go and tell this people, keep seeing but don't see, keep hearing but don't hear. Can you imagine as a pastor, you show up in the pulpit or a Sunday school teacher and you say, today I don't want you to hear. Today I don't want you to perceive. That's what God commands Isaiah. And then he says in verse 10 that he's going to make the heart of this people heavy. They'll have eyes but can't see, ears but can't hear. That's what he's going to do through Isaiah's ministry. It's very difficult. But the reason this is the climax of judgment in chapters 1 to 6 is that they have been exhorted again and again in the history of Israel, stop your idol worship. But they were intractable in their non-repentance in worshiping idols. And you see that in chapters 1 to 5 as well of Isaiah. Finally, we come to a definitive judgment. God says, you like idols? Okay. I'm going to make you like those idols. The idols have eyes but can't see, and ears but can't hear. You're going to become as spiritually inanimate as those idols. You're going to become just like them. You love idols? You're going to become even more like them than you thought. Spiritually inanimate. Intractable in your sin, this will be a judgment that will not be reversed. And so then we go to chapter 7 through 11, which the theme of it is a deliverance for an Israelite remnant. And then chapters 13 to 23. All of those chapters, each chapter, is a judgment on a Gentile nation. Moab, Babylon, so on and so on. Every chapter, judgment on a Gentile nation. Judgment on a Gentile nation. Chapter 23 is judgment on a Gentile nation. Chapter 22, this is about Israel. Judgment on Israel. Why are they in the line of judgment of Gentile nations? Because they become like the Gentiles. In fact, Isaiah, in chapter 1, verses 9 to 10, and chapter 3, verse 9, says they become just like Sodom and Gomorrah, as do some of the prophets as well. They say that. And so they've just become just like the nations. That's our context as we look at chapter 22 now. So as we continue to move on, let's look at the immediate context. What we have here is Israel is condemned, demonstrating that she was to be judged just like the unbelieving and sinful pagan nations. She comes to be identified with the nations, as we just said. And then, in 22, 1 to 14, what we find is that there is a description of the wrong conduct of the people of Jerusalem during a siege and their defeat by the invading armies. Basically, in verses 1 to 14, you get a prediction of judgment upon Jerusalem carried out by means of the Assyrian army, who is the punishing rod of God. So it's a prediction here then, as we see, of judgment. That's the first half of the chapter. Now, we're getting closer. Now we come to the verses very close to our quotation, chapter 22 and verses 15 to 19. And let's read those. I'd like you to read with me in your Isaiah text. If you'd open to Isaiah chapter 22. And we get a fellow by the name of Shebna. Says this, thus says the Lord God of hosts, come, go to this steward, to Shebna, who is in charge of the royal household. What right do you have here, and whom do you have here, that you have hewn a tomb for yourself, you hew a tomb on the height, you who carve a resting place for yourself to the rock. Behold, the Lord is about to hurl you headlong, O man. He's about to grasp you firmly, roll you tightly like a ball to be cast out into a vast country. There you will die, there your splendid chariots will be. You shame of your master's house. I will depose you from your office. I'll pull you down from your station. The main point of that passage is Shebna is to be deposed. And so then we come to our passage in verses 20 to 25. So that's the prediction about Shebna. He'll be deposed. And then we come to our verses. And so let's read them. Then it will come about in that day that I will summon my servant Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah. Now, you'll notice that sometimes I'll have underlinings. This is my interpretative rendering of the verses. So this is kind of the Beale's Living Bible, if you will, at this point. So I'm going to summon Eliakim for my purposes, okay? Then, verse 21, the first of it. Why will I summon him? In order that I'll clothe him with your tunic and tie your sash securely about him. Well, what does that mean? We get an interpretation. This means I'll entrust him with your authority. And in particular, what else does it mean? He'll become a father to the inhabitants of Jerusalem and to the house of Judah. Furthermore, it means I'll set the key of the house of David on his shoulder, which means that when he opens, no one will shut. When he shuts, no one will open. That's our quotation. Verse 23, then I'll drive him like a peg in a firm place, with the result that he will become a throne of glory to his father's house. This means, what does that mean? That they will hang on him all the glory of his father's house, offspring and issue, all the least of vessels from the bowls to the jars. This is just figuratively talking about the descendants of Eliakim, who in some way will be dependent upon Eliakim himself. In that day, declares the Lord, verse 25, the Lord of hosts, the peg driven in a firm place will give way. Okay, that's figurative. What does that mean? Well, means it will even break off and fall, with the result the load hanging on it will be cut off. In other words, all these relatives benefiting from the privilege of having Eliakim as basically the chief of staff for the King Hezekiah, a huge, big position, they're going to be cut off. The reason Eliakim and his dependents will fall is because the Lord has spoken. Now, you remember with Shebna, the main point of that narrative there that we read of verses 15 to 19, the main point was, I'll depose you from your office. The main point of our passage is this right here. Eliakim and his dependents will fall. Why? Because the Lord has spoken. That's what it says. Now we're going to see, why has the Lord spoken that Eliakim must fall? That's going to be very important for understanding how this text relates to our New Testament text. And so, as we look at this passage then, Eliakim displaces Shebna. And by the way, this phrase, if you look at verse 22, it says, I'll set the key of the house of David on his shoulder. Well, that house of David is a reference to that kingly office that was going to be characterized by an eternal royal reign and kingdom promised to David. 2 Samuel 7:13 and 16, Psalm 89:4, Psalm 132. These are all passages in 2 Samuel and the Psalms that predict this house of David that will rule and rule eternally. That's what we're talking about here. In some way, Eliakim is being given a huge amount of authority. It's sort of like the chief of staff to a president. We've known in some cases, some of those chiefs of staff virtually control the president. In other cases, they didn't. Well, in this case, in some way, Eliakim was equal in authority to King Hezekiah. And so much so that you can say that I'll set the key of the house of David on his shoulder. That's amazing. And so what does it mean there in verse 22? If we come back, notice this language. When he opens, no one will shut. When he shuts, no one will open. Well, as the chief of staff, if you will, or the prime minister to Eliakim, no one's going to get in to see the King Hezekiah unless they enter through Eliakim. If he opens for you, you're there. You can ask for favors of the king, etc. If he shuts, that's it. No entrance to see the king, no privileges to be gotten from the king. In fact, that Eliakim is so much equal to King Hezekiah is apparent from the language. If you remember the language of, shoulder, rule, father, throne, and David, all those are describing Eliakim, those words. Guess what? Those are the same group of words that describe the messianic child in Isaiah chapter 9 and verses 6 through 8. So my point is that this, he's really seen as the one who has charge of the house of David. He has a huge, huge position here. Now, let's keep going. So, here's our main idea of the text. The main idea of the text is this. God will appoint a servant Eliakim to replace evil Shebna in order to rule in the best interests of Jerusalem, bringing glory to his relatives and eventually falling from office. And it's that's the main point. It says, because Yahweh has spoken, because God has spoken. So it's Shebna's narrative was moving toward being removed. This narrative is pointing toward the goal of Eliakim also being removed. So let's just summarize here. Eliakim was to have absolute control over the kingly office of the house of David. That's what opening and no one shutting and shutting and no one opens means. He's got absolute control. Now the surrounding context gives us further information about his office. So I want to point these things out to you. Notice that in verse 20, he's called a servant. Look at verse 20. Then it'll come about in that day, I'll summon my servant Eliakim. That's very unusual. And most of the uses of servant in the book of Isaiah have to do with either Israel or the messianic servant who takes over Israel's role. So that is kind of like neon lights saying, this is an important word. Eliakim is seen as an important figure, at the very least, here. And then we've got the office may have included priestly connotations. Well, that's very interesting. I don't know if you picked up on that, but look at verse 21. and I'll clothe him with your tunic and tie your sash securely about him. Tunic, that Hebrew word, wherever it's used elsewhere, always priestly clothing. And tunic, sometimes the clothing of a king, sometimes the clothing of a priest. But I think probably there are some priestly connotations here. Well, that's very interesting. I don't know how so, but we do know that sometimes kings had some priestly roles like David did. Remember, he wore the ephod. And so in some way, there's something priestly about Eliakim. Third, the duties of the office mainly concern political rule over the inhabitants of Jerusalem, Judah, and over the house of David. That's verse 21. I'll entrust him with your authority, with your rule. He'll become a father to the inhabitants of Jerusalem and to the house of Judah. And then, as ruler, Eliakim was to be a father to the people, as Shebna had not been. We just read that. He was to be a father over the people. So that he was to be such a ruler as to have fatherly concerns over the people. The opposite of most of the religious rulers throughout Israel's history and on into the New Testament with regard to the Sadducees and the Pharisees. Next, Eliakim's power was equal to that of King Hezekiah. We've already talked about that from different angles. He clearly had the authority of the house of David that he was responsible for and that he was exercising. Eliakim's ability in performing the duties of his office would bring glory to all of his relatives, even the least important. Look at verse 23 in the second part again. He'll become a throne of glory to his father's house, so that will hang on him all the glory of his father's house, offspring and issue, all the least of vessels, from bowls to all the jars. Again, that's figurative for saying that he'll bring glory to all of his relatives. Probably involved here is nepotism. You know, sometimes you find sometimes people get promoted in companies because, oh my goodness, the person promoted is a cousin of the boss or the son-in-law or whatever. You've seen that again and again and again. And then Yahweh made his office secure and successful, right? Look at verse 23 again. I'll drive him like a peg in a firm place, and he'll be able to hold up others. Then this glory is bestowed upon them only as they are in a dependent familial relationship with him. Okay? We basically just talked about that. That the only way they get glory is in their relationship to Eliakim. So, next, Eliakim's office of kingly power was not to last forever, so neither would the glory of his relatives last forever. So he's cut off, and his relatives are cut off. And so again, to reiterate, the logical and theological emphasis rests on verse 25, and we're going to see for redemptive historical reasons. We've already gotten a pattern, haven't we? A possible beginning pattern. Shebna's removed. Eliakim's removed. What's going on here? And so now we come back to step number five. Now remember, step number five is a comparison of the texts. And we're going to skip that. I will mention this here before we go to step number five, that the opening and closing at the end of verse 22 are metaphors expressing the power of royal administrative control. And we've talked about that. Okay. So just to reiterate again, the main idea of our passage that we started with, Yahweh will appoint his servant Eliakim to replace evil Shebna, to rule in the best interests of them, bringing glory to his relatives, and eventually falling from office. Now, we're not going to look at this. We looked at it before. And if you want to look at that, if you know Greek and Hebrew, that's fine. But we can do what we want to do with the English text. We've already seen that Revelation 3:7 is dependent on the Hebrew and not on the Greek. But what the Greek text does tell us, it gives us sort of an early Jewish interpretation, doesn't it? The Greek text, for example, tells us that the key of the house is interpreted as glory and as rule, and that this idea of opening and no one shuts and shutting and no one opens is interpreted to be, no one's going to contradict Eliakim. He's got too much power. Nothing they can say can change his mind. And so that's the idea. And so basically what you want to do on step 5 and 6, what text does the New Testament rely on? We've already decided that. It relies on the Hebrew, probably to drive home the idea of the Hebrew text and not the Greek text, which is so different. And then, so that really takes care of steps 5 and 6. However, before we go to step 7, something very important here I want to point out, and it gives us a further look into Jewish ideas. What we have here, besides the Greek text representing an early Jewish tradition, remember there were Jewish Greek interpreters, translators of the Greek Old Testament. Here, we'll just skip by the Greek text here. This is a Greek text. Ah, the Targum. Now the Targum, don't let that technical word throw you. It's just the Aramaic translation of the Hebrew. That's all the Targum is, okay? Probably came about 4th, 5th century AD. So it's a little later. But what it says is intriguing. Here it is. I'll clothe him with your robe and gird him with your cincture and place your authority in his hand, and he shall be a father to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, to the house of Judah. Now look. And I will place the key of the sanctuary of David and the authority of the house of David in his hand. And he will open and no one shut. He will shut and no one shall open. So remember we talked about this robe up here and the other piece of his clothing having priestly connotations. The Targum saw that. The Aramaic translation brings that out in its interpretative translation. So that's very interesting. It goes on to say that Eliakim will be a faithful officer ministering in an enduring place, actually. He'll become a throne of glory to his father's house. And it continues. All the glorious ones of his father's house will rely on him. The sons and the sons' sons, from the princes to the juniors. Notice, who else will rely on him? Priests, wearing the ephod, to the sons of the Levites, holding the harps. Wow. So again, there's a priestly association. Even the priests will rely on Eliakim. And yet, he'll be cut down. And it's the oracle of the prophecy that was concerning him. And it will not be voided. So it is decreed. So basically what the Aramaic translation does, it brings out this priestly idea even more. Now, we've done the first 6 steps. I'm not going to go all the way back up to show you the 7th step. But remember that the 7th step, if you want to look at the beginning of our lecture, remember that 7th step is analysis of the interpretive use of the Old Testament. Revelation 3 in its context. Analysis of the interpretive use of the Old Testament. So at the least, this is analogical, isn't it? One text is being compared to another, right? Eliakim is being compared to Jesus. So at least we have analogy. But I think there's reason to think that more than a mere analogy is in mind here. I think that there may be what Dr. Glad described as indirect typological prophecy. Now, what we want to do at step number 7 is to, I apparently don't have that on the overhead. So at step number 7, we want to troubleshoot. We want to take those 12 uses that Dr. Glad talked about. And we want to say, is this direct fulfillment? Is this indirect typological fulfillment? Is it analogy? Is this a prototypical use of the Old Testament? Is it a symbolic use of the Old Testament? On and on and on. And when we look at this, I think that probably, I'm going to contend, it's not a mere analogy, but that John views Isaiah 22:22 as a foreshadowing. Eliakim is a foreshadowing of Christ, not through direct verbal means, but through the events narrated about Eliakim, which came to pass within the Old Testament period. Now someone said, you mean to tell me that Isaiah was aware, as he was writing this, that Eliakim was a foreshadowing of Christ? Well, some would say, no, if it's a type, then remember that element of retrospection with typology? Well, after the resurrection of Christ, the coming of the Spirit, then we can see things better. Could Eliakim have been aware of this, however? I'm going to contend, I think he was. I think a lot of these foreshadowings, these what we call typological prophecies, you can just call them foreshadowings or event prophecies. My wife likes event prophecies. She hates the hyphen. She's a highfalutin. What do you call indirect typological prophecy? Just call it event prophecy. And so that's fine with me. And so I'm going to argue that he was aware that this was a foreshadowing. It's not a direct verbal prediction, but it is a historical prefigurement of what was to take place on a grander scale later with the future Messiah. And so here's the main correspondence that I see. The main typological correspondence between Eliakim and Christ is that as Eliakim, Christ was to have absolute control and power over the Davidic throne as king. Whereas Eliakim's authority was primarily political and exercised over a physical kingdom, the immediate context of Revelation 3:7 underscores Christ's kingdom began in a spiritual manner. So, furthermore, his sovereignty is said to be exercised with respect to whom would be received or not received into a spiritual palace or kingdom. That was Eliakim. And now, it's Christ. He is the one who has sovereignty as to who is accepted into the spiritual palace and who is not. So, very interesting. Remember I said that these introductions, remember what the introduction is in our passage to Christ in Revelation 3:7? He is the one who is holy, who is true, who has the key of David, who opens and no one will shut, and who shuts and no one opens. How does that develop chapter 1? Where does chapter 1 talk about the keys of David? Where does chapter 1 talk about opening and closing? Or where does it talk about he who is true? Well, we know that in chapter 1, in verse 5, we have that this book is from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, ruler of the kings of the earth. And that idea of faithful witness, that basic word for faithful can be translated true in some cases. So that might be the development of true here. He's developing the idea of Christ being a true witness, but how about opening and closing and the keys? Well, if you have your Bibles open, look at chapter 1 and verse 18. Jesus is presenting himself alive to John. I'm the living one. I was dead. Behold, I'm alive forevermore. I have the keys of death and Hades. That's too coincidental. That text is being interpreted as him now having the keys of the house of David. So the expressions are too similar to have keys in this way, especially since all of the introductions of Christ's self-presentations go back to chapter 1. This has to go back to him being described as having the keys of death and of Hades. But keys of the house of David is substituted for the keys of death and Hades. And the reason is that Christ has sovereignty over the sphere of death and Hades. That's what chapter 1 of verse 18 says. And he has that authority also as the one who has the keys of the house of David, as the Messiah. So the point of the citation from Isaiah is that Jesus holds the power over salvation and judgment. Revelation, in that verse, 1:18, the stress is on sovereignty over death and judgment. In 3:7, the emphasis is on his authority over those who either enter the kingdom or do not enter the kingdom. John compares the historical situation of Eliakim in relation to Israel with that of Christ in relation to the church. In order to help the readers better understand the position which Christ now holds as head of the true Israel, as head of the temple, if indeed Eliakim had this these priestly connotations. So Christ's kingship begins to be exercised over a spiritual realm. At the consummation, it'll be both over a spiritual and a physical realm. So some other aspects of this, and so our main typological correspondence here is that Christ was to have absolute control and power over the Davidic throne as king. And he would have absolute control over who enters the divine palace and who doesn't. That's the main point, just as Eliakim had that control. But there's some other things here, and I'm not saying they're all in mind, but this is the help of looking at that wider Old Testament context that we looked at. So the context of this quotation may tell us the following notions that I've listed here may also be in mind in this typology. For example, Eliakim was specially appointed to his royal office by Yahweh. So Christ was appointed to a greater divine royal office by Yahweh. Secondly, as Eliakim's office may have included some sort of priestly concerns, such concerns were made a primary connection concern with Christ's royal office. Where? Well, in chapter 1, he's walking among the lampstands. That's what the priest did. And in addition, he's pictured as a priest in the Son of Man vision. But the very fact he's walking among the lampstands and tending them, that's what the priest did. He's a priestly figure. And that's carried on, I think. Thirdly, Eliakim's political control was over Jerusalem, Judah, and the house of David. Christ was over the world. There, you see, we get escalation. All of these are an escalation of what Eliakim was to do. Next, Eliakim was to be a father to the people. So was Christ on a grander scale. Wow, that's interesting. Is this the is Christ being ceasing to be the third person of the Trinity here? I don't think so, since Eliakim certainly was not being seen as the third person of the Trinity. I think that Father here has to do with that kingly concern that the king who was rightfully king, doing those things a king should do, should have a fatherly concern. Eliakim was to have that. Christ has it on a grander scale. As Eliakim's power was equal to the king's, so would Christ be to God's. Just as Eliakim's office was made secure and successful by Yahweh, so Christ's political spiritual office was to be made such not only by God the Father, but by himself as God the Son. Eliakim did not have the intrinsic qualities and power to carry out his office, but Christ, being worthy and true, did. Note that in Revelation 3:7, Christ does not receive the keys from God. He already has them. Remember, the Hebrew text says, I will give the keys to Eliakim. Christ already has the keys, and that may be significant here as to Christ's qualifications. Again, these are a lot of notions that may be swallowed up in this main typological correspondence of Christ having control over the spiritual realm. I'm not sure if all of them are in mind. A lot of them, we might put it this way, that when you're driving, you got your central focus, but you see in your peripheral vision if there's a pedestrian or whatever, and finally at the very edges of your peripheral vision, things get foggy. Well, I think some of these are in the peripheral vision of Christ as he is quoting this. Others may be right toward the edge of it. I think that's the way I think I would like to put it. So as Elikam's, as his ability in performing the political functions of his office would bring glory to others, so Christ, he would bring glory to others as well. We know that, even in the book of Revelation. And just as this glory was to be bestowed on all of Elikam's physical seed, as they were in a dependent relation to him, so we got to be Abraham's seed. And remember, Christ is Abraham's seed, and we have to be related to him to share in his glory. Whereas Elikam's office of kingly power was not to last forever, here's the big difference. Christ's was. In fact, Shebna doesn't last. Eliakim doesn't last. And we're going to find that the reason for that lacking, the reason you have commission failure, is to point to one who would come and fulfilled. And so Eliakim's seed was to have temporary glory. Christ's seed was to have eternal glory. Now, I want to stop a minute because so far I've just claimed this is typological. It's not just analogy. But I haven't presented evidence for it. I've just shown these parallels. How do we know that this is a foreshadowing in Isaiah 22:22? And not just an analogy. And it makes a difference in what you're going to teach or preach. How do we know? A lot of people have seen a lot of typologies, and they've been crazy. In fact, this evening I'm going to talk about how do you put restraints on wild typologizing. That's going to be part of the message. So what I want to do is talk about why I think this is not just an analogy. Yes, it is, but it is a foreshadowing analogy. There's a comparison, true, but it is a comparison that involves a foreshadowing. And so the first thing, let's look here. Number one, whenever David is mentioned in connection with Christ in the New Testament, there are usually discernible prophetic messianic overtones. So here we have, he has the keys of David. Whenever David is mentioned, and usually it's in connection to Christ, he's seen as a fulfillment of something in the Old Testament, often Davidic prophecies. And I have a number of passages here. And even when you have House of David, as you do in Luke 1:27 and 69, there again, it is prophetic. You have Tabernacle of David in Acts 15:16. There it's talking about fulfillment of prophecy. So that's the first hint, okay? There's an association with David. Second, the reference to Elikam as my servant in Isaiah 22:20 would have been easily associated with Isaiah's messianic servant prophecies. That's such a startling term. And as we saw, it's like a neon light. Pay attention to me. And then I think we can further say number three is really crucial. And that is the description of placing the key of the house of David on Eliakim's shoulder, the mention of him being a father to those in Jerusalem, to the house of Judah, and the reference to him as becoming a throne of glory would all have facilitated a prophetic understanding of this narrative about Eliakim. Why? Remember I already said that the key terms in our passage of shoulder, father, throne, and David occurred in Isaiah 9, 6 through 7. And I think that Eliakim is being painted with the description of the messianic child. And it ends up, nope, he's not the one at the end of the passage. He's not the one. But what we find here is Isaiah certainly would have been aware that he was painting Eliakim with the description of the messianic child, and would have been aware that he was not the one. But what that shows is painting Eliakim with the descriptions of the messianic child from Isaiah 9 is clearly associating him with the Messiah. And at the end, no, he's not the one. But that means somebody's got to come and fulfill Isaiah chapter 9 if it's not Eliakim, if it's not Shebna, and so on. Another point that Isaiah 22:22 is viewed with a prophetic typological sense is further evident by observing the intentional allusions to prophetic servant passages in the immediately following context in Revelation 3:9. These passages here are references back to passages about restoration that are linked to the servant. Number five, and this is the most intriguing. When various segments of the Old Testament contain repeated clusterings of narrations about Yahweh commissioning people to fill certain offices, whether it's judges, priests, prophets, kings, the repeated failure of the ones commissioned, followed by judgment, and followed by the same cycle of failure again and again and again, is the narrator's way of pointing the reader to think of one who would come and fulfill the commission. In other words, take the judges. You have these narrations. Judge is commissioned, does okay, and then there's a failure by the judge in Israel. Then then a punisher comes, puts Israel into bondage. They cry out. God raises up. He commissions another judge. And for a while does well, but he and Israel fail. And again and again and again, we get that. So what you get are these narrated cycles crunched together of commission failure, commission failure, commission failure. And why? Well, I think the reason is not just to show human depravity, but the readers would have been aware at the time of Isaiah of Genesis 3:15 that the woman's seed would defeat the serpent, and of Isaiah 49 that Dr. Glad was looking at today, verses 9 and 10, the Messiah would come. Numbers chapter 24, 14 and following, where again, it's a messianic prophecy. They would have been aware of this, and so I think they would have seen, somebody's got to come and do this. Who better? Yeah, it's got to be this coming Messiah. And Isaiah would have said the same thing. Hey, this person who's being painted like the messianic child, this is a messianic kind of person. Uh-oh, not the one. He fails. And so this is the lack points forward. And so here, what I want to do is, you have this in your notebooks. It might be best for you to follow with me. This is from Gerhard von Rad in his second volume of his Old Testament theology. Von Rad is not an evangelical, but he has some of the best things to say about typology in his second volume. It's amazing. And here's one thing he says, and so follow along with me. This is really an important principle for discerning typology elsewhere in the Old Testament. The range of Old Testament saving utterances is that which tells of the calls of charismatic persons and people summoned to great offices. In the case of certain descriptions of the call and the failure of charismatic leaders, Gideon, Samson, and Saul, we're dealing with literary compositions which already show a typological trend in that the narrators are only concerned with the phenomenon of the rise and speedy failure of the man thus called. Here, too, in that case, there's fulfillment, proof of the charisma and victory. Suddenly, however, these men are removed. Yahweh can no longer consider them, and the story ends with a reader feeling that since Yahweh has so far been unable to find a really suitable instrument, the commission remains unfulfilled.
Well, I wouldn't say that Yahweh is unable, but that's his language.
Can we not say of each of these stories that Yahweh's designs far transcend their historical context? What happened to the ascriptions of a universal rule made by Yahweh to the kings of Judah? It is impossible that the post-exilic readers, here I would say readers of Isaiah, and transmitters of these messianic texts saw them only as venerable monuments of a glorious but vanished past. These men, Saul, David, Eliakim, all passed away, but the tasks, the titles, and the divine promises connected them with them were handed on. The Shebna Eliakim pericope is a fine example of such transmission. The almost full powers of the unworthy Shebna pass over, solemnly renewed to Eliakim, yet he too will fail. Thus, the office of the key of David remained unprovided for until finally it could be laid down at the feet of Christ. And so, what I'm saying is these repeated clusterings, and you get partial clusterings in Isaiah 22, but these repeated clusterings like you see in Judges or in the list of kings, the narrator's purpose in clustering those together, speedy rises and falls, is his way as a historical narrator to get our attention and to realize that the lack is pointing forward. The lack is a typological kind of pointer. And then we can go to number 6. The use of Isaiah 22:22 and Revelation 3:7 meets the essential requirements of a type. I mean, you've got to have correspondence, historicity, escalation, predictiveness, and a retrospective interpretive stance. And we have all those. And so now we've got to categorize this passage. It's not just analogy. This is an indirect typological prophecy. And now in this step 7, determining the interpretive use, you want to see, is this used anywhere else in the New Testament? If it is, you want to see how that could shed interpretive light on your text. This one is not. Some think it may be used in Matthew 16:19. Carson doesn't say much about it. There's debate. I'm not going to go into that. So let's go to step number 8. Almost finished. Step number 8. And that is theological implications. Theological implications. Okay. Having a little bit of a delay in the clicking here. Is our battery getting dead, Hamid? Okay. Okay, the first thing we want to look at is Christology. That's number 1. And we should be clicking there in a second. That's a long already. So, Christology. So, what you want to do, you want to look at your systematic theology textbooks. Make yourself aware of the categories of theology and troubleshoot. Is this Christology? Is this ecclesiology? Is it theology proper? And by the way, there are also what we call biblical theological categories, like temple, Eden, second Exodus. You're not going to find those as major subjects in a systematic theology, okay? But if you want to make your apprise yourself of those categories, look at the New Dictionary of Biblical Theology, edited by Desmond Alexander and Brian Rossner. Now, if you want to make yourself aware of the systematic categories, you want to at least have in your library the following systematic theologies: Burkhoff, Turretin, and Bavinck. You've got to have those. Whether or not you're a professor, a pastor, whatever, you need to have those. They're wonderful. So Christ here, remember he said to be holy and true in verse 7. And that phrase, holy and true, in chapter 6 and verse 10,
refers to Yahweh, refers to God. This is a divine title. And in fact, the phrase Holy One of Israel in Isaiah is used 20 times of Yahweh. So these are references. I'm the Holy One. I am the Holy and the True. This is the language of deity. And so he's being identified with God here. So, and we've seen that was already the case earlier, that as Eliakim was equal to the king in the Old Testament, so Jesus is equal to the king. So, and now our second one is soteriology. Christ's salvific authority pertains primarily to his sovereignty over who enters into the kingdom. Christ opens to some while he shuts the door to others. Salvation and exclusion from the kingdom are based in Christ's determinate will, not human will or actions. Nevertheless, in the context of Revelation 1 to 3, one's response to Christ's death and resurrection is essential to those who find entrance or exclusion, though ultimately it is Christ. I mean, when Eliakim was around, someone could say, I want to come in to see the king. And but Eliakim could prevent that. This is a pretty difficult theology here, because what we're arguing, this is not unusual in Reformed theology, but we're not only arguing for unconditional election here, whom Christ opens, they enter, but to whom he shuts, they don't enter. And so that would be the doctrine of reprobation. And so this is a very sobering here, just as... I was talking to someone the other day, they were in a Bible study, reading a book called Raising Hell with a Z. And the idea of the book is, there's no eternal conscious hell. And this was a book that's being used at a rest home for older folks. And that's very serious, to deny eternal conscious punishment. Nobody wants to think about that. It's not a pleasant idea, is it? No. And neither... is this a completely pleasant idea? But then when we come to the next one, to the third theological view, and that is eternal security. To whomever Christ opens the door into the kingdom, that one will remain there forever. I'll make him a pillar in the temple of my God. He will not go out anymore. That's the promise then, isn't it? Ecclesiology. Christ is depicted as the head of the local church, the Davidic king of the true end time Israel, guiding their activities and opportunities. In this respect, we talked about what the church means. And evangelism. This is amazing. Christ's sovereignty in providing the Philadelphian Christians an open door of salvation is also an open door for them to be effective in conveying the message of salvation to unbelievers. Such an understanding on the part of these Christians likely was a motivation for them to share the message of the gospel. And likewise, it is a great encouragement to us as well. Notice the next point. Oh, Hamid, we got to fix this. All right. Motivation to live for Christ in the midst of trials. Remember, they have a little power. They've not denied Christ's name in the midst of persecution, and so they are suffering. And yet in the midst of that, Christ says that he's going to open the door for them. So they need this encouragement because they have a little power in comparison to the rest of society. The assurance is meant to motivate them boldly to continue to persevere in the face of opposition in identifying with Christ and proclaiming the gospel. And likewise, this is to give us assurance in the midst of opposition. We have a little power, really, when you think about it, with this looming culture of secularism that's beginning to invade more and more. We have a little power, but Christ will open that door. And remember that evangelism is twofold. Yes, opening the door to hearts, but for those who reject, it becomes the basis for their judgment. But I remember a fellow lived next door to me in Wheaton, always snowed in Wheaton. And when it started snowing, he was right out there with a snowblower. He had a brand new snowblower. And I think his wife might have given it to him. And it, just an inch of snow, he's out there. He's doing it. I'm not doing it. And so that starts at 5, let's say. Keeps snowing, snowing till 11, 11:30. Finally, the implicit command comes. When are you going to get out and shovel the driveway, Greg? I had no motivation to do that. Why? Because I had a gravel driveway and I had a jagged old metal shovel. I didn't have the power to do it. My neighbor had all the power in the world, and he could show his gratefulness to his wife by using that snowblower every hour, every hour. I had no power. But Christ is saying these people, even though it doesn't look like they have the power, he's going to open doors for them. And I believe that he'll open doors for us. One thing I've been praying, and with this I'll close, is that, you know, I teach at a seminary, so I'm around believers all the time. But I'm praying, Lord, bring unbelievers across my path. And somebody said, well, you know what? Your students are going out and the unbelievers are, you know, crossing their paths. But I'd like to encounter more unbelievers. And this is what Philadelphia was encountering. And they had all the motivation in the world because they had the power of Christ on their side. He introduces himself with, to whom I open, no one closes. Do I close? No one opens. And that indeed is what was going to happen. The Jews, who were called the synagogue of Satan, Christ then says, I'm going to make them come and bow down before you and know that I've loved you. I think that's speaking of their conversion. It's amazing. Well, let's close in a word of prayer. Lord, we ask that you would help us understand your word and that it would cause us to increasingly be able to reflect your image and your glory. We pray in Christ's name.